Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I'd like to just let everyone know that Miles Briggs has given his apologies for this meeting. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item of our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Town and Country Planning Development Planning Scotland Regulations 2023 from Joe Fitzpatrick, who's the Minister for Local Government Empowerment and Planning from the Scottish Government. And Mr. Fitzpatrick is joined by the Scottish Government officials, Kristen Anderson, who's the Principal Planner, Andy Kinnaird, who's the Head of Transforming Planning, and Carrie Thompson, who's the Head of Development Planning and Housing. And I welcome witnesses to our meeting, and I'd like to invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I think the last time I was at this committee was as Convener of Session 4's Local Government and Regeneration Committee. I note Mark was a member way back then in 2011, but that said, in preparing for this morning, I felt a little bit soon after my appointment to be facing a double committee session, but it is good to be back. So I'd like to thank the committee for this opportunity to briefly outline the approach to the new development planning provisions. The provisions are contained in Scottish Statutory Instrument 2023 No. 101 and the associated Commencement, Saving and Transitional Arrangements regulations. Scotland's plan-led system of development is widely supported. As you are aware from your consideration of National Planning Framework 4, the Scottish Government is strengthening development planning as part of our wider planning reform programme. That includes changes to what constitutes the development plan, the interplay between NPF 4 and LDPs in terms of policies, and the process of preparing local development plans with a greater focus on delivery. Together, these changes create opportunity for LDPs to refocus on delivering place-based outcomes. The broad framework for new-style LDPs and their preparation is set out in the primary legislation, the Planning Scotland Act 2019, which made strategic changes to LDPs. These regulations provide the detail of how the Act's requirements should be fulfilled. The new regulations were informed by extensive engagement with key stakeholders, with inputs from the Cross-Sectoral Development Planning Working Group that led to public consultation on the main regulations and draft guidance, along with the consultation on draft NPF 4 and a separate consultation with targeted engagement on the definition of gypsies and travellers. Overall, respondents were generally supportive of our proposed approach of carefully targeted regulations. More detail will be provided in the fuller associated guidance. I can assure the committee that the regulations were finalised taking account of the comments raised through the public consultation. The policy note sets out details of the consultations, including issues raised, and the regulations now reflect that feedback. We've not included all of the suggestions put forward within the regulations themselves, but will address the matters raised in the guidance. That connection between the regulations and the guidance is key. We've sought to strike a balance between having a clear statutory framework and clear guidance to support all stakeholders in implementing the new system, whilst giving planning authorities flexibility to implement the statutory procedures in ways that best suits their places, their communities and their own organisational priorities. We also intend to identify and share best practice as the new system beds in. So we welcome the opportunity to come back to the committee to talk through the comprehensive guidance once it is published, if that's something that the committee would be interested in. Commencement number 12 will commence various provisions of the 2019 Act needed to support the envisaged new system of LDPs. And we have also provided savings and transitional arrangements for plans that started under the current system. We know from our discussions with stakeholders that planning authorities are eager to get on with their new style plans, and these regulations will provide a solid foundation for a consistent approach to plan making across the country. So I look forward to answering your questions with perhaps a bit more support than usual from Kirsten, Carrie and Andy.
Great, thank you very much for that. And I'm certainly aware of the eagerness in my local authority. There's been some great work already initiated around local development plans and community engagement. You began to touch on this, but I'd be interested to hear a little bit more deeply. How did the Scottish Government consult on the regulations? What significant issues were raised during the consultation, and what changes were made in the light of representations received?
OK, so obviously there was extensive work at the start. The cross-sectoral development working group was involved right from the outset, so before we put pen to paper. There were three subgroups which looked at procedures, evidence, reports and the gate check, and the scope and content, each of those produced outputs in February 2021, offering information on their ideas to support development of the regulations. In terms of the public consultation on the proposed LDP regulations and guidance, there were more than 14 weeks between December 2021 until the end of March, and that ran alongside the consultation on the draft NPF4. So I guess that allowed people to have a kind of joined up understanding as they were looking at the consultation. There were 87 responses received from planning authorities, key agencies, development property and land management bodies. I think really importantly, there was a separate consultation on the definition of gypsies and travellers, which ran between December 2022 and February 2023. So that enabled targeted involvement of the community and opportunity to explain the specific matters associated with the definition and specific context in terms of which it was used. So that allowed four in-person consultation events with travelling community members. And I actually think 41 responses to that, but I think if you look at that, there's probably a good example of best practice about how we engage with communities which sometimes appear to be more difficult to engage with in terms of consultations. In terms of the issues raised, there was generally broad agreement, I think, with the majority of the proposals. Overall, there seemed to be agreement that the regulations should be kept to a minimum, supporting the flexibility and ability to address potential problems arising. So we were able to make some changes to the traffic regulations on a few areas, but on balance, many of the issues raised were dealt with in or will be dealt with in the guidance rather than the regulations, in terms of that principle of keeping the regulations really to a minimum to make sure we have that clear legal framework, where the guidance, which can be updated based on best practice, was where most of the other points from the consultation were taken in. Kristen, have I missed any bits that you'd like to fill in?
That's the main points. Just there was a few points of detail that we covered and updated in the regulations. For example, some members of the business community wanted to ensure that examinations, there's an opportunity for them to comment on any further information that's provided. So we provided for that. As the Minister indicated, we've added the definition of gypsies and travellers, and the feedback, there was quite a lot of consensus on the changes that required to that definition, which we've taken on board. And we've updated some of the information and considerations that planners have to take into account when preparing their local development plan. And there's things in there that we've added around the climate change agenda, so adding in things around national and regional marine plans, open space strategies and flood risk management plans.
Thanks very much for that. Good to hear about the additional kind of clarity around climate. I'd be interested to hear how you expect a planning authority to go about developing an evidence report, and what opportunities will there be for communities and individuals to input into the process?
Yeah, so the evidence report is really important to make sure that there's robust evidence-led plan making. So obviously it should provide that summary of what the evidence means for plan making, and the aim is to front load that work. So you were asking what the process is.
About how the authority would go about developing it exactly, and then the opportunities for communities and individuals to input.
Okay, so the really it's really important that it's front loaded in terms of that involvement with the community, and that's one of the crucial things. It's important in terms of involving community at the earliest opportunity. I'm going to ask Kristen to just help me if you can.
Sure. So the Act already sets out different groups that that the Planning Authority has to engage as it's preparing its evidence report. So those groups cover quite a wide cross-sector people. So it includes the key agencies, specifically children and young people, and it sets out those types, including school pupils, youth councillors and youth parliament representatives. It also includes the public at large, so that's quite a large catch-all category that covers most groups. And then they've also got to set out how they include a statement within the evidence report of how they've engaged with disabled people, gypsies and travellers, which we spoke about earlier, and community councils. So we think that we've captured a wide range of engagement. And in terms of that engagement, the focus really is on that kind of early collaborative engagement to inform the how sufficient that evidence is, rather than the kind of more formal just responding to a report. So it's about a more kind of embracive, holistic approach to engagement.
Okay. In terms of engaging with young people or any of the groups you've identified, is pretty much up to the Planning Authority to decide how they go about doing that?
In terms of the methods?
Mm.
Yes, but there will be separate statutory guidance which we'll be bringing forward on effective community engagement and development plans. So that's going to be published fairly shortly.
And I guess that evidence report that has to be produced is actually the key to that, to make sure that engagement is appropriate for the local place and the local communities. So it might not be the same everywhere, I guess, is the key point.
Yeah. Thanks for that. I'm going to bring in Annie Wells.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, panel. Following on from Ariane's question, I was just wondering, Minister, if you could explain why the Scottish Government has chosen not to establish minimum evidence and consultation requirements for evidence reports.
Yeah, so I think one of the big concerns would be if we had laid out in the regulations minimum requirements in terms of the evidence and consultation, then that could very much be seen as the bar and could very much be seen then as a tick box exercise. So this is about us kind of trying to get a system which is able to adapt. So the guidance will be really, really crucial in terms of that. But I think there's a real danger if we set those kind of minimum requirements, then that is seen as actually what we aim for, and then we've ticked the box and then we move on to the next thing. So hopefully that's the way that it will be seen by folk engaging, but crucially because so much will be in the guidance, it will be easier for us to adapt that going forward. It will be a living document, so not a edition one, edition two, so we can make sure the guidance makes sure that we support everyone to engage in the way that we expect it to.
Yeah, so that will be continuing to be monitored throughout this, yeah. And anything you would come back to the committee with, anything that changes in that?
So the guidance, I'm happy to come in and speak to the committee when the guidance is published, but yeah, it will be a live document, and if the committee feels that there's been a significant change to that, they want to discuss further then.
Perfect. Thanks, Minister. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. We're now going to move to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you, Joel. Could you just say a wee bit more about the gate-checking exercise, and maybe for the benefit of the committee and anybody watching, just explain briefly what is gate checking? Is it a series of tests that need to be applied to almost verify that the LDP is compliant across a broad range of issues? That's my estimate of this. But just broadly, what is it, and will it be the same in every local authority, or do the local authorities get to define it themselves?
Okay, so the assessment of the evidence report is what we're terming the gate check. It's obviously a new process. So that will provide an independent assessment of whether the planning authority has sufficient information to prepare an LDP, and that be carried out by a person appointed by Scottish ministers, usually a reporter from the Planning and Environmental Appeals Division. So it's a new independent process. Do you want to add a little bit more about gate checking? Because it's a new process.
So as the Minister outlined, it will be for the reporter to consider whether there's sufficient information within that evidence report, which compiles the different types of evidence, which will allow them to progress to the next stage of preparing their plan. So it's almost like the baseline information and as to whether there's enough information of what to plan for, and then the proposed plan sets out where things go.
Mm-hmm. But does the reporter issue some guidelines about what should be in it? Or can local authorities determine the context and makeup of it themselves?
It'll be for the reporter to decide the procedure. They'll provide the evidence report, and we'll set out in the guidance some templates of what the evidence report should look like. And then it's up to the reporter whether they want to invite further written or oral procedures to assess that information.
Okay. And any resource implications that you can envisage with that process? Any additional resource requirement you anticipate might be needed to make sure that that's a smooth process?
Yeah, we've been in discussions with our colleagues in DPA, the Planning and Environmental Appeals Division, and they've been aware and preparing for these new changes, this new stage, since the Planning Act in 2019, so getting themselves ready for that. And they're also reaching out to planning authorities across the country, particularly the ones who are going to be the kind of early pioneers, to get them ready, including in terms of the kind of like logistics of how they'll present that information, upload it to their kind of data servers, and just to kind of make sure that they have those conversations kind of early on.
I guess we expect planning authorities to develop these plans over a period of about 5 years, so that they're not all going to come at once. So there's, I think, six authorities that we think are kind of ahead of the game, and then so it should be phased over a period of time.
Okay, thanks for that. And another query I have, Minister, is about the sort of online map-based provision for plans and so on. I'm certainly aware of East Ayrshire's capability in the planning department with the online mapping systems, but is that broadly available across Scotland? Are there any technical resource requirements and issues that you're aware of for authorities to implement these systems?
So we're working with the high-level group to look at the range of skills that are required for the new plan, so just ensuring that we have performance improvement and necessary reform to support that cross-sectoral approach to the kind of range of skills, including the mapping skills, and if there's additional resources. But anything specific about the mapping? Sorry, Andy.
I can maybe just come up in a bit on that. Another sort of really crucial element of the overall sort of wider planning reform programme is the work that we're doing just now in the digital transformation of the planning system and of services. And one key element of that is how we can sort of better use reliable open access data and map that out around the country so that we know that authorities and those who may be looking to invest in development will have access to that same information mapped out.
That's not available across the board at the moment, though?
Not yet. It's something that we're actively working on at the moment.
And who do we help to support and fund local authorities that need to invest in that, or are we expecting them to make that investment?
No. It's our digital programme's a six-year, £35 million investment by the Scottish Government, working with the authorities and wider stakeholders.
Yeah, excellent. So just again, Minister, the system we've seen at East Ayrshire is really good, and the local people really engage with that.
I'm sure there'll be somebody from East Ayrshire hearing what you're saying, and there'll be an invite on its way to come and chat with them.
Right, many thanks for the answers to those questions, Minister. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I actually got a couple of supplementaries on that. On the previous question, you mentioned that there are some local authorities that are already ahead in the process. Can you tell us which ones?
Kristen?
You can write to us.
Maybe we're better just writing to
us. Some of them are like Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park Authority.
Right.
I think Mid Lothian, Fife. But we are just having those conversations. And I think that the Improvement Service is providing us with data from all the local authorities on their timelines. But we are expecting that some of those may kind of overtake each other. And I think some are kind of eager to learn from Fife and the others as the kind of early doors.
Okay, thanks very much for that. And then the other piece on the mapping, what level of detail is that mapping going to? What kind of information would we get from the mapping system?
It's sort of looking at lots and lots of different layers of different types of information. So it can be around what development plans are already allocating for land. It can be where there are designations, could be environmental designations of bits of land, vacant and derelict land, all these things. It's all kind of data that can be map-based and can sit on layers of that.
And is that system robust enough to kind of go to the level of if we wanted to set up a cadastral system at some point, that would be possible in that system?
So that's certainly the thinking at the moment. It's a piece of work that's the early days of scoping out exactly what it's going to do and how it's going to shape. But we kind of see it sitting with a platform on which development plans, including national planning framework, can sit in the future.
Okay, yeah. Great. That's good to hear that it's something that we can kind of grow arms and legs and be very useful, because it's clearly been, you know, that's been an issue, is the whole kind of mapping of Scotland.
Most of those significant changes were brought in by the Planning Act itself, rather than these legislations. Yeah. So that's why work is ongoing.
Thanks. We're now going to bring in Ivan McKee with questions.
Yeah, thanks very much, and morning, Minister and officials. It was round about the requirements on planning authorities to notify owners and occupiers of land neighbouring development sites that are identified in a proposed plan, where that proposal may have a significant impact on their land, and about the resource implications of that. So it was just to ask, what consideration have you given to what those resource implications may be, and if there was any thinking about additional resources being made available to support that?
Yep, I think we're generally comfortable that the majority of the changes aren't made by these regulations. As such, the majority of the changes would have been made by the Planning Act that is already in place. And as I say, we've tried to keep the regulations to a minimum. Andy, was that? Or?
Just going to say that requirement is in the existing system already, in the existing
right.
arrangements for
okay.
preparing local
okay.
development
That's clear.
Plans.
Okay.
It's not, yeah, it's not new in these regulations.
Okay.
Thanks. And Marie.
Minister and your officials, can you explain how you decided on the list of key agencies to be consulted by the planning authority when drafting the LDP, and there are not some obvious omissions, you know, such as like Network Rail and Visit Scotland?
So the key agencies are really the same key agencies that were in the 2008 regulations. There's some changes because some of the organisations have changed their names. So Scottish Natural Heritage is now Nature Scot, for instance. And there's a couple of new agencies which, so South of Scotland Enterprise, for instance, effectively has the same role as Highland Island Enterprise, obviously different geographies. So that's the kind of main changes. But largely it is just based on the 2008 regulations. In terms of which agencies were key and which were not, some of the agencies that might make sense to be key agencies, Transport Scotland, Marine Scotland, these are agencies of the Scottish Government, so it's absolutely important that they're engaged, but the legislation wouldn't allow them to be key agencies because of the nature of their of them being effectively part of the Scottish Government. But guidance will make it clear that even some of those big organisations should still be connected. I'm trying to think of the two that you mentioned. Was it
Network Rail and Visit Scotland?
So obviously Network Rail was a part of the UK government, but nonetheless the regional transport partnerships are in there. So I guess, and I think Visit Scotland's probably in a similar place to the other groups.
Thanks for that clarification.
Yep. Great, thanks very much. And Mark, got a question.
Thanks. Good morning, Minister. I wonder if you're able to set out how the government feels that local planning authorities should kind of balance the policies and proposals that they consult on and develop locally with maybe any potential competing interests or clashes that there might be with NPF4. How you do expect planning authorities to resolve those? And you talked about the guidance that you're planning on releasing to supplement NPF4. I wonder if you're able to give an indication of when that might be.
So in terms of MPA4 sits alongside, I think that's, and the Act sets out the requirement for planning authorities to take MPF into account when preparing their LDP. So it's a bit different. So I think in the past you would have expected the National Planning Framework to virtually be replicated within in the local plans, so that's no longer necessary because they sit alongside each other. So I think that's a much more it's a more sensible way of working. You're right, the guidance is really crucial. Do we have a kind of expectation in terms of when?
The time, we're expecting it at or around the time, maybe just shortly after the regulations come into force, but we're talking about days.
Okay.
So coming very soon, certainly during May.
Yeah, so soon.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. I think one of the concerns, I don't know if this is the right place to ask this question, but I think one of the concerns I have is we've got MPF4, then we've got local development plans, and then you've got my favourite topic, which is local place plans. And I see Andy smiling there because he knows I bring it up. So I think one of the concerns I have is we've got these local development plans that are maybe going to take 5 years to create. So that's an interesting and useful bit of information, actually. But if a community hasn't got on board with, you know, they're not at that point where they're going, oh, we want to create a local place plan. How do you see, you know, if you've got a plan, a local development plan that's kind of done and dusted and this is it, you know, here it is, how will communities be able to then at a later stage, you know, how will their local place plans be honoured and respected, and, you know, the local development plan opens up and gives space for that community expression?
Yeah. So, I mean, the regulations we're putting in place is all about trying to make sure that we're getting that engagement when we're doing that. But it, you know, it's absolutely appropriate that we kind of have those different layers, and it's all about trying to get engagement at the earliest possible time in terms of interfacing with place.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, the provisions around the local place plans were intentionally light touch, so that we were trying to, I guess, brigade local communities into doing something by a particular time, so they can bring forward a local place plan at any time through the life cycle of the LDP. Alongside sort of the work on these regulations, we'll just shortly be starting work on the regulations that are required for how you would make amendments to the local development plan, so it could be within that 10-year cycle. So an in-process kind of amendments that can be made. So there would still be opportunities if there are local place plans that the authority then wants to take forward the proposals from within that. They could just make amendments to their LDP.
Okay. Look forward to seeing that regulation. I think that's it. So thank you very much for the evidence on this today. It was very helpful. I think that we've got some useful bits of information there. The Minister will be staying with us for our next evidence session, as he said at the beginning, but I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow for a changeover of supporting officials. Thank you. we're just... The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the community planning inquiry. This is the final evidence session before we reflect on all the evidence we've heard in recent months and consider what conclusions we might draw from it. A final report will then go from the committee to the Scottish Government, and we are joined for this session again by Joe Fitzpatrick, the Scottish Government's Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning, and for this session, Mr. Fitzpatrick is joined by Scottish Government officials, Andrew Connell, who's the team leader from Public Service Reform and Community Planning, and David Milne, who is also a team leader from Public Service Reform and Community Planning. And we are joined online by Councillor Stephen Heddle, who's the Vice President of the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, COSLA. And Councillor Heddle is joined by, again online, by Simon Cameron, who's the Chief Officer at Workforce and Corporate Policy from the Workforce and Corporate Policy Team, and Lucy Devlin, who's Policy Assistant at the Workforce and Corporate Policy Team at COSLA. And I welcome all of our witnesses this morning. We'll try to direct our questions to a specific witness where possible, but if you'd like to come in, please indicate to the clerks, and Councillor Heddle, if you can do that by typing an R in the chat function, we can bring you in. And there's no need for you to manually turn your microphones on and off, as we'll do that for you. And I now invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss community planning as part of its ongoing post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. Convener, as you're aware, Part 2 of the Act introduces reforms to community planning and provides a statutory purpose for public sector bodies to work together and with communities to improve outcomes and reduce inequalities. This Government is committed to community planning. It enables genuine partnership working and provides an ideal platform through which to address the deep-rooted and complex social, economic and environmental challenges that affect communities across Scotland. As a result, the place-based actions that community planning partnerships take on local priorities also support important public service reform ambitions for the Scottish Government nationally, for example, eradication of child poverty, economic transformation and a just transition to net zero, and tackling health inequalities. The Scottish Government is conducting an informal review of Part 2 of the Community Empowerment Act, which covers community planning. This review builds on practical learning and engagement with partners, including the Community Planning Improvement Board, to ensure community planning is as effective as it can be. And I know that the committee has heard evidence from a range of witnesses, all of whom have valuable experience of community planning. I've noted their examples of successful community planning in practice since the Act, as well as where there is potential for continued improvement in how community planning operates in practice. Committee's findings and recommendations will inform our review and help us to further improve community planning so that it supports our ambition to enhance partnership working and improve outcomes for communities across Scotland. So I look forward to receiving the committee's report in due course and continuing to engage with members on how to ensure community planning continues to help improve outcomes for communities across Scotland.
Thanks very much. And I'd like to invite Councillor Heddle to make a brief opening statement, if you'd like to.
Yeah, thanks very much. And thank you, Chair, for the invitation to the panel to give evidence alongside Mr. Fitzpatrick today. I very much welcome his opening remarks. I think it shows both local government and Scottish Government are on the same page with respect to this. And I too would like to reiterate the local government's commitment to community planning. I think it's fair to say that the aspirations expressed by Campbell Christie remain as valid as ever. And you know, we endorsed these aspirations at the time and remain committed to carry them through, particularly around the areas of early intervention and prevention. I think the evidence has been gathered so far shows that there maybe is still a distance to go. This is reflected in the findings to date. And I would say that, as COSLA, we recognise and support these findings. But personally, I was slightly surprised at the the findings in respect of third sector interfaces, because in my own area, I feel that we have a very good relationship with the voluntary sector, and indeed they do work for us. But I think this just shows the kind of progress that we can make nationally, learning from each other. I think in terms of the findings to date, we'd certainly underline the ones that speak about the need to enable the commitment and contribution, particularly of partners, particularly of national agencies or bodies under national direction, to be able to be responsive and flexible at the local level. I mean, in short, I would say through our evidence today, COSLA's hoping to emphasise the importance of the participation engagement from all partners and relatedly to highlight the need to situate community planning within the broader work on public service reform, which Mr Fitzpatrick referenced. And you know, this obviously includes the local governance review. We very much believe that fully empowering local partners to work meaningfully together and to reduce barriers to collaborative working will help to achieve the better outcomes both locally and nationally, and respond to the issues of place that have been highlighted. Our objective clearly has to be better services and better local decision making, and not just cost cutting to balance national budgets. We feel this is very much a place based initiative, and you know, it has to do what it says in the title in terms of community planning. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Councillor Hill. I'm going to open with a number of questions around culture change before we move on to the other themes that we've been exploring in the evidence session so far. So back in 2015, community planning was seen as central to public service reform in tackling inequalities and aiding prevention, as you both articulated. And the committee heard that the picture on the ground is very variable. Again, you've picked that up. And I'd be interested to hear from your sense what impact community planning has had. And maybe I'll start with the minister.
Okay, thanks very much. I think public service reform, particularly how we deliver effective and efficient public services, has got to be supported by effective community planning. So that work is key to achieving the cross-cutting missions set out by the Scottish Government's policy perspective, including tackling inequalities and aiding prevention. So the critical message, one of the three priorities for the Scottish Government from the recent budget, is that public service remains sustainable and well-placed to improve outcomes and reduce inequalities. So we're reinforcing this in our engagement with public bodies, many of the statutory community planning partners, and emphasising the need to pursue opportunities to do this both alone and in collaboration. I guess you mentioned the degree of variability, but by the very nature you would expect there to be variability, but it's obviously for the government to ensure, it's the government's role to ensure that the Act and its implementation on the ground remains fit for purpose. So that's why the then Minister for Public Finance and Planning and Community Wealth announced the review that we're taking forward, and why I welcome the work of this committee.
Thanks very much. Councillor Heddle, do you want to come in on that?
I think it's important to say that variation is in itself not a bad thing, and we would always resist the idea to brand local variation as a postcode lottery. And I mean, this is often as a result of choices made due to local need and indeed availability of finance locally. So, you know, as Mr. Fitzpatrick said, variation is to be expected. I think but absolutely we would want to improve the situation. In terms of the culture change for statutory partners, obviously the Act placed new responsibilities for participation on the bodies, but I think we need to go beyond that to enable the, as I said, the national agents to free up the local offices to participate more fully locally. I think this is perhaps a shortcoming that could easily be overcome, and would certainly improve the collaborative working locally, so that the partners would be participating rather than attending, which is sometimes the case. And I think this has been found in the evidence given so far. I think the situation there is one that's perhaps understandable. I mean, we have to ask ourselves the question, what is the key priorities for our partners? Are they those of the community planning partnership in the police? Or are they the targets that are set by their employers and their ministers? And I think we need to be able to get to a better balance of both, so that it can be more biased towards, or shifted more towards, the priorities of the community planning partnership and the police. And I think we have the opportunity to do it through both the work being done here and the local governance review. And indeed, the work that we hope to take forward in respect of community wealth building as well, I think that's also going to be relevant.
Thanks very much for that. And actually, that you've set me up very, very well for my next question, because I think I'm starting to understand community wealth building. That is the bill that's going to be coming through the committee at some point. And in my kind of like deepening my understanding on that, I start to see that community planning partnerships could really be the place that a good part of community wealth building could be delivered. So I'd be interested to see, you know, what you think the role of CPPs going forward are, you know, with community wealth building, but also COVID recovery is something that has been talked about through our evidence sessions, and also the New Deal for Local Government. And maybe because you mentioned the words community wealth building already, I'll start with you, Councillor Heddle.
So I must be more careful in the words I use going forward. I have a sore throat today too, so I'm not really wanting to hear the sound of my own voice. I should say that. Community wealth building, I think, is a very exciting thing to take forward, and obviously is being led primarily, I guess, by our colleagues in Ayrshire. They've done a lot of work towards that, so we're looking towards them as exemplars of what we can achieve in respect of that. And I mean, clearly this is sort of tied in also with participatory budgeting, so I'm not leading into a question on participatory budgeting here as well. But it's sets on participation, and the participation also of partners is key in this, as well as retaining wealth locally. And the way to do that, obviously, is to make sure that all the kind of local actors are involved. And the Community Planning Partnership obviously serves as an important forum to keep everybody in the loop. The value of keeping everybody in the loop is if people can respond to that. So, you know, returning to the empowering our agencies and our partners, as well as local government, to be able to respond to the local priorities is key in this. I'm starting to lose the thread here. Remind me if I'm not answering your question?
That's right. No, you're doing a fine job. It was just really about CPPs and the role going forward. But I think one of the things you've talked about there about the importance of CPPs in terms of the community wealth building bill being a forum that can keep everyone in the loop. But I would also imagine that there's also an incredible opportunity there for, say, in Orkney or wherever we are, of working with those partners to identify, for example, local procurement, where, so we're actually starting to bring procurement locally through those agencies. That's something that I'm starting to get really excited about.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that can go beyond the vanilla procurement to work on collaboratively to support supported employment and such initiatives as that. And I mean, the discussions that we have in Orkney, I'm a member of the health board as well, so you know, we share experience in respect of that to deal with the supporting employers. Yeah, I'll probably stop there if that's okay.
Yeah, that's fine. So I'll come to you, Minister. So I kind of really focus on community wealth building, but it's more a kind of general question, because that's my passion at the moment. But it's more a general question around how you see the CPPs going forward, the role of them for the wealth building bill, but also in COVID recovery and also in the New Deal for Local Government.
Okay, so I think community planning is going to continue to have a really important role in supporting a range of priorities like COVID recovery, promoting population health, tackling health inequalities. But I do think increasingly there will be a role for community wealth building, as you've mentioned, so particularly in terms of economic development in our communities. That's obviously been led by the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance. So I'll ask David to comment and indulge your passion. But I think there's also an increasing role in climate action, so supporting community-led, place-based approaches. So I think there's a really exciting opportunity there, and if we get that right, then I think there'll be huge benefits. In relation to the New Deal, we're continuing discussions with COSLA and CPIB and other partners to support improvements to community planning within the context of the New Deal with local government and the local governance review. But David, do you want to indulge a convener? Sure.
Thank you, Minister, and good morning, everyone. Yes, I mean, community wealth building, in a sense, is almost like a tool that feeds other local priorities. So the role of public sector bodies as employers, as procurers, as owners and operators of estates and assets, how are they used to best support economic development and improvement, and also some of the kind of social and environmental challenges facing local areas? The work on the Community Wealth Building Bill is actually built on some good experience, much of which has taken place at community planning partnership level already, including in North Ayrshire. Collaborative work that's been incorporated into some local outcome improvement plans, for instance, in Midlothian and in Dundee. So, and as well as that, some public sector bodies, notably public NHS boards, are developing their own roles as anchor organisations. So recognising actually how they undertake their work is as important as the work that they do. Just briefly on COVID recovery, maybe this also reflects, convener, back to your initial question about culture, in that in light of the pandemic, I mean, we witnessed some dynamic working through CPPs anyway during the pandemic, but also subsequently, in that most CPPs have reviewed and either have or are in the process of updating their local outcome improvement plans to reflect the changing reality, both from COVID recovery and increasingly in the current cost of living crisis. So different manifestations, but all focused on the same underpinning issue, which is that it's the communities in Scotland that have for decades been most disadvantaged, that have suffered most through the pandemic through the current cost of living crisis. And that's really an area where, by working together in community planning, the partners can make a difference.
Thanks very much for that, David. It's good to hear that in terms of the community wealth building, that, I mean, my sense is there's a buzz in Scotland and that people are kind of like pushing the process already in a way, eager to get on with it, as a tremendous opportunity, and great to hear about the work that, you know, obviously we've had that experience in the pandemic, and obviously that's, I like that you talked about dynamic working. So, obviously that's great to hear that experience has kind of fed into changing and adapting. Councillor Hedder, I believe you wanted to come back in, and after that we'll move on to the next theme.
Yeah, thanks, Chair, for your indulgence here. It was a reminder that I hadn't actually responded in terms of the COVID recovery point. And I mean, COVID, the pandemic was obviously an example of how both local authorities in their own right and the community planning partnerships as well can respond to a crisis effectively and at pace. And I mean, we have to recognise that the COVID pandemic and the funding that followed it placed us in a kind of unusual situation where the availability of resource wasn't so much an issue. It was a challenge on us to spend the resource we have effectively and quickly. And I think both the councils and the community planning partnerships rose to the challenge. And I'm sure this will be audited, and I remain confident that the councils will be shown to have responded very effectively and economically. But the rapid response is the kind of the principle, I think, that we should bear in mind, that the community planning partnerships can bring to the fore, given that it brings together the various groups. And as David Milne was saying, in the context of the pandemic, we've updated our priorities, but we've also convened other members onto the community planning partnerships that can offer advice and relevant information. I mean, particularly in respect of business partnerships coming on to the community planning partnerships, as we attempted to maintain the viability of our local businesses. But I mean, in general, the kind of previous examples I would say have been around youth unemployment. This was a priority that brought together the local authority, the Job Centre Plus, and the third sector to work very effectively in our area to make very concrete inroads into the field of youth unemployment. And you know, this is just simply an example of how the community planning partnerships can work together very effectively and quickly.
Thanks very much for that. I said we'd move on, but actually now I've got another question, which is, you've both talked about the importance and the effectiveness of community planning partnerships up till now and also going forward. And I'd be interested to hear your view on the funding of CPPs and if the current approach, do you think the current approach to that funding is effective? Minister, I'll start with you.
Okay. So there are some really good examples of partners aligning the resources, notably staff and premises, towards a shared purpose so that collectively they can achieve more than by working separately. So I think the important point in relation to funding is that partners should use their collective resources in whatever way best enables them to deliver on local priorities in line with their own organisation's role and responsibilities. So I have heard the arguments that partners should allocate funds towards a pot of money which CPPs control, and I'd be interested in learning more about the benefits and risks of that approach. And obviously that's one of the things that you've been looking at. I think there are recommendations coming out of the Community Planning Improvement Board also, which I'm looking forward to discussing with the CPIB chair, which I have not yet discussed. So,
okay, thanks. And we seem to. Do we still have Councillor Heddle? No. Okay. Maybe is there anyone on the team who wants to pick that up? Oh, he's back. All right, you're back. Great. You're on mute at the moment. We'll just get your mic on for you.
Yeah, apologies, my connection went out. Did I miss a question?
So it was just a question about funding. Did you hear about that? Did you hear it, or do you want me to say it again?
Oh yeah, I had your initial question. Yeah. I think this is an issue because the situation at present is that the resourcing of community planning partnerships is primarily by local authorities, dedicated staff to perform the clerking role. We do the bulk of the work in preparing the local outcomes improvement plan, and we really could do with more buy-in from our partners. It's difficult enough at present to resource the staff we have working on the LOIPs jointly. I made the point, what is the key priorities for partners? How invested are our partners in the community planning partnerships? They don't have a statutory financial investment in it. There's an expectation that they're going to contribute. And whilst I don't want to be directive of our partners, I think the expectation could do a bit more to be in realised to contribute to the running of the partnership. And
dropped out again. Okay, I think we got the bulk of the response, and that was very helpful. I'm now going to move on to the theme of tackling inequalities, and Annie Wells is leading on that. Annie,
thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. We know that participation and engagement are hugely important when it comes to community planning. But I would like to ask the Minister, firstly, is what more should be done to ensure that marginalised communities, including communities of interest, have a voice in the community planning process in each local authority area? We know it differs in each local authority area, and even within some areas within a local authority area. So I just wonder if I could get your take on that, Minister.
Yeah, so as the member says, community engagement is really important for community planning, given its focus on improving outcomes and reducing inequalities. And engagement at personal or family level is particularly important for households experiencing disadvantage to understand what matters to that household around which suitable responses can be shaped. But direct engagement using the usual methods might not always be appropriate, so we need to look at different ways to ensure that they have the opportunity to have their voice heard on the issues that matter to them and feel confident that those views have been heard. So looking at some of the examples that you've had, it's interesting to hear of CPPs looking to engage with people in less formal settings where they're likely to already be. So, for example, the North Lanarkshire CPP engaging in schools and health centres, East Ayrshire CPP hosting an annual joint session with Children and Young Persons Cabinet and local MSYPs. So I think we need to look at how we can do more of that and share that best practice. It will be variable because by the very nature, communities are different, places are different. But I think it's good to see some examples of CPPs reaching out to make sure that they're not just... I think the concern is that you're just hearing from the same folk and not hearing the people who are most impacted by the plans that they're intending to take forward.
Yeah, that's kind of what we've been hearing as well. And I don't know whether Councillor Herrill had anything to add to that as well from a local point of view.
I would agree with the Minister's reflections there. I think that it's absolutely true that we probably can do more to reach out to the marginalised communities and communities of interest, and that we should be doing this. And, you know, if we were to set out a plan how we do that as part of our LOIP, or do more in terms of that, I don't think that would necessarily be a bad thing. I think the involving our partners and reaching out is obviously a powerful tool of the Community Planning Partnership in Orkney. We do much of our engagement using the voluntary sector. Voluntary Action Orkney often lead on the community engagement for us, and indeed have conducted exercises in each of our ferry-linked islands, because obviously even within Orkney there's issues of insularity and double insularity with respect to the mainland on which I live. So, in terms of localities, this is one of our localities, so we're obviously obliged to reach out to them and to reflect their opinions. So, simply, I would agree that we can do more, and the CPP is the vehicle to do this, involving our partners.
Thank you, and thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. We're now going to move on to our next theme, which is community empowerment, and Mark Griffin's leading on that.
Thanks, Convener. It's been 8 years since the Community Empowerment Act was passed, and I just wanted to ask the Minister and Councillor Heddle whether they can point to any evidence that shows that communities are more empowered now than they were back then when the Act was passed, and come to the Minister first.
Yeah, I mean, the whole purpose of the Act was to empower communities, so it's a reasonable question to ask for examples, and I think there's kind of three areas that, if I can, I would like to highlight. So the first is participation requests, which help people to start a dialogue about the things that matter in their community, so that allows people to have their voice heard in policy and service development through contributing to decision-making processes. And then to challenge the decisions and seek support for alternatives which obviously improve outcomes. So since 2017, there have been 75 participation requests made, and that includes community participation in outcome improvement processes for things like peer safety issues, local road improvements, future of local police offices and improvements to community halls. The second area I'd like to flag up is the asset transfer legislation designed to encourage and support ownership and control of assets by communities. So since coming into force on the 23rd of January 2017, there have been 203 asset transfers have been agreed, and there's obviously more in progress. So that's including parks, woodlands, sports and recreation facilities and community hubs. So helping to reduce inequalities by ensuring all communities can be in control of their outcomes and environments. And the final area, which I think Councillor mentioned briefly, so I don't know if I'm flagging this up for him, is participatory budgeting. So a tool for communities empowerment, which enables local people to have a direct say in how public money is spent. And there have been an impressive scaling up of participatory budgeting in Scotland over the past few years, with over 200,000 people deciding on how money is spent in their local community. So that's kind of three areas where I think we can see real involvement, and I guess it shows why it's so important that we keep up doing this work to encourage more involvement from communities, more empowerment.
Okay, thanks, Minister. Councillor Heddle, did you have anything to add to that? Are you able to point to anything that shows a more empowered nation than it was when the Act was passed?
I think, we can do more. We can expect more in terms of travelling towards the aspirations of both the Community Empowerment Act and also the aspirations in terms of Campbell Christie envisaged. I think we would like to see the partnerships empowered more, to be able to empower our places more, and we'd like to be able to make more progress in respect of the early intervention and prevention agendas, which is key to the fundamental success of the community planning partnerships as originally envisaged. In terms of the provisions of the Act, I think one of the things that's perhaps surprised me is the fact that community asset transfers have not happened as much as might have been expected. And in my own area, what we've found actually is that in terms of asset transfers, we find that our community organisations are quite happy for the local authority to maintain maintain ownership of the asset, and maintain the asset itself, rather than pass the burden of responsibility to them. And this has been something that's prevented asset transfers taking off to the extent that we expected. So, maybe a review of that would be relevant as well, as to why this laudable aspiration of asset transfers is perhaps maybe not taking place as often as had been envisaged.
Yep. Thanks for that. Yeah, it's been my experience that quite often the asset transfers happen because the local community don't want to lose it when it's proposed for foreclosure, and it's almost like the last resort. So I think that's a helpful comment, Councillor Heddle. I can come to my second question and just to ask if we're doing enough to build capacity in communities, whether we're doing enough to support communities to get involved in decision making, and as well as that, how we're supporting the existing infrastructure, what role the community councils have in community planning as well. Perhaps come to Councillor Heddle first.
Yeah, in terms of building capacity, building capacity is very important, and this brings us into the issue of local police plans and how they fit into the landscape, because we're absolutely clear that in the planning terms, we must make sure that the local police plans aren't just a tool for wealthy and well-resourced communities, but also a tool for the communities perhaps don't have the organisational capacity and don't have the resources to put these things together. So this has long been a concern of local government. And so this kind of cascades into how do you empower communities in terms of the wider community planning agenda. At present, absence of resources issue. I mean, how do we can give communities a voice through consultation, but you know, how do we support them to make informed decisions? How do we support them to produce plans to take forward things like asset transfers? You know, how do we do that? It comes back to, I'm sorry to say this, the kind of under-resourcing in the local government and the fact that we're £1 billion short of where we'd like to be compared with where we actually are. Otherwise, we would be able to do more for our kind of marginalised communities, to support them, to make the full use of the tools available to them.
Thanks for that. Minister, anything to add on?
So I think in terms of capacity, we need to recognise that it's never going to be a done deal. So we need to continue to build and invest in building capacity. So one of the ways that the Scottish Government does that is by funding the Scottish Community Development Centre, the SCDC, who in turn support community-based groups in Scotland to engage with participation requests. You asked about community councils as well. Obviously, community councils are one of many community bodies listed in the statutory guidance, and CPPs should engage with them constructively. I'd ask David if you want to add a little bit.
Thanks. Just very briefly. Thank you, Minister. I suppose maybe just one thing just to add to this is the importance of community engagement and empowerment being very much a kind of relationship building approach. So it's not simply exercises of engagement, it's actually public services locally building long-term relationships with the communities, which provides a platform from which communities themselves can at least get scope to understand what they're capable of doing themselves, how they can fulfil their aspirations and build the capacity around all of that. As the Minister says, the support for SCDC does provide assistance for community bodies in that respect. Also, the reviews that are taking place of other parts of the Community Empowerment Act, including on Part 3 and Part 5 around participation requests and asset transfers, I think we'll be getting into that space as well.
Okay, thank you.
I believe that Councillor Hill wanted to come back in briefly.
Yeah, thanks again. Thanks again, Chair. It's on the point about the community councils, and I think that's a point well made. But community councils are an important democratic layer of our democracy, and I think it's important that the community planning partnerships do consult community councils, but the community councils themselves need to be empowered as well. I know that across Scotland there are issues in people to participate in community councils.
That's unfortunate. It'd be good to have heard that. Okay, I think we better move on and. Have we lost everybody now? No. Okay, good. Okay, so thanks, Mark, for that. We're going to move on to the third sector and communities with Ivan.
Thanks very much, Convener. And before I start on that, I just wanted to, if it's okay, ask a brief supplementary to Mark Griffin's question on evidence. And the Minister went through a number of examples of work that was being done. But the information we've got, if you look at the Scottish Household Survey in 2015, 24% of people in Scotland felt they could influence decisions affecting their local areas, and that was 24%, and in 2019 that dropped to 18%. And I believe that's also reflected by a worsening performance in the National Performance Framework around about community empowerment indicator on social capital. So when you look at that hard evidence, it kind of suggests that things have got worse rather than better. So I'd really just like to get the Minister's reflections on that, and if that's something that's on the radar and drives the approach to understanding whether we're making progress or not.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess the question was, for examples from when the Act came in. So I had three main examples from that, but you know, I think it is absolutely appropriate that we look at this. It's why the previous minister ask for a review to take part and why I welcome the work of this committee, because I think that the fact is that the more local engagement we have, the more communities are involved in decision making, the better decisions we're going to make, and so that's absolutely something that I think we recognise, and why, you know, as I say, I welcome the work that this committee is doing.
Sure. Okay, thanks. So, yeah, two areas I wanted to touch on. First was on the third sector, and obviously I'm new to the committee, but if I look back through the official report and picking up on the work that Paul McLennan was investigating as part of that, and I think it's fair to say that community anchor organisations, the third sector, Development Trust, expressed quite a number of frustrations with community planning, and certainly my own experience in Glasgow, the CPP, although it's got the word community in its title, is very, very far away from communities. In actual fact, there's two layers below that at sectoral level and then at area partnership level before you get to anything you would actually be able to fairly describe as being engaging with what you might describe as a community. So I suppose the question is, what can be done to make sure that third sector organisations, anchor organisations, development trusts, that those frustrations are allayed and they've got more of an input to the work of CPPs, and also perhaps a reflection, and it was interesting to hear Councillor Heddle's comments on Orkney, which obviously a community of 20,000 people, very different from a community of 650,000 people, whether there's a structural issue there that kind of prevents CPPs from doing the job they should be doing and getting close to what actually happens on the ground.
Yeah, so I mean, the statutory guidance is absolutely clear in relation to third sector organisations and third sector interfaces. The third sector has an important role to play in community planning, you know, at a strategic level around the board table, but also with that engagement that we were talking earlier. Sometimes the third sector will be the organisation which can engage with the communities that we're particularly trying to make change for. So it is really important that they are part of the picture, helping to build capacity, skills, confidence in communities, and, you know, in general community empowerment activity. So there's lots of reasons why the third sector should be involved. I guess your question was whether there's something within the current structures which is preventing that. I would argue that's not the case, because there are some really good examples where the third sector have been able to be engaged. So particular examples that I have in front of me, Perth and Kinross Association of Voluntary Services co-chairing the CPP, so they're not statutory member, but nonetheless they're co-chairing. Engaged Renfrewshire chairing their CPP forum for empowering communities. And the strong involvement of Largo Communities Together. That's their anchor organisation in the Fife Loip. So I think there's nothing structural. So if there's places where that isn't happening, then I think there's strong arguments for why it should be happening. And you know, if the only one was to reach those communities that we're trying to support in terms of inequalities and deprivation, then that would be a reason for doing it. Do you want to add anything further about?
I think, Mr. McKee, you raised the question about actually the communities being divorced, maybe two or three levels away from CPP. And from my reading of previous evidence, there was a bit of a debate around actually the significance of that. An argument made that actually what matters to communities is that they feel confident that public services will come to them, will listen, and will actually do something based on what they hear. They don't arguably necessarily need to know that that is being channeled through a CPP formal structure. And increasingly, the way that CPPs are organised, I think it's probably fair to say, this is a general point, but a lot of the work is being decentralised. From board level to thematic groups or locality groups, and actually in many cases quite informal working, including among frontline staff there. And it's really at that level potentially where actually the importance of those people working in public services, engaging with third sector and directly with communities, really just to get a sense of what matters to them and responding to that.
Yeah, I think that's a fair comment. I think it was described as kind of the glue behind the scenes, if you like, in one of the one of the papers. I suppose it doesn't take away from the fact that when I engage with local community organisations who do great work on the front line, and I've got many frustrations in many areas, they tend to work and coalesce together organically, but there isn't a sense that this is something that the CPP or any other structure is adding value to. In fact, the area partnerships are seen as much of a, or largely as a mechanism for funneling funding to local organisations rather than anything that's pulling anything together strategically and coherently. And indeed, community councils have actually got a role to play there as well, which is quite important. So I suppose it's just to reflect back on that frustration that was expressed about third sector not feeling part of that that process. And by the time you get to it, it's a kind of third sector interface, which again is quite far removed from the people on the ground who are actually delivering real stuff in real communities.
Sorry, I thought that was
comment on that. And I don't know if Councillor Heddle's got any reflections on any of that, bearing in mind, say, that Orkney's maybe got a different experience due to size. I think it's frozen. Okay, sorry. I'll move on to my next point, which was round about engagement of the business community and delivering community empowerment, again, and a very important strand at a local level, and what steps can be taken to ensure that's effectively involved. And as part of that, I'm just going to reflect, reading through the evidence that obviously I wasn't engaged in, the work of Scottish Enterprise and other enterprise agencies was referenced. And really just to give a perspective on that from my previous work in with businesses and enterprise agencies, I was actually surprised to see Scottish Enterprise referenced, and I know that they're actually mentioned as one of the stakeholders, because to my experience working with them, their role is much more at a national strategic level, working to build world-leading industrial and technology clusters that make Scotland competitive, rather than being involved in the nuts and bolts of what happens at a very, very local level. And I would have thought that was more of a role for Business Gateway, frankly. So I just welcome any reflections on that as well.
Yeah, so obviously engagement with business is important for community planning. Businesses are part of our local communities. That's kind of the starting point. So they can and should play a role in community planning and improving outcomes for local communities. I mean, some of the particular ways that the business community are involved is in supporting likes of Fair Work and making connections with employability schemes. So there's definitely a role, and there's some really good examples of where that has been taken forward. A couple of areas that I have examples of for where there's been really good work would be the team in North Ayrshire, where developed to address North Ayrshire's job density figures of 0.5, so 5 for every 2 people of working age population, by providing local businesses with tailored support to help them develop and grow. Businesses are given a single point of contact from which they can access all the available support to them through the council and other EDR partners. So that approach provides a tailor-made support that reflects the specific needs of business, and an external evaluation conducted in 2018 showed that TNA delivers £19 million in additional wages, £39.5 million in GVA and 590 jobs. So showing, if we get this right, there's a real plus to having business involved. And the other example I have would be the partnership working in the Outer Hebrides, so a very different area, but recent best value audit reports that the council found that it's worked closely with local economic partners, including Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Business Gateway, Skills Development Scotland and Stornoway Port Authority, and including through co-locating teams in the council's main office. So I mean, that's obviously a bit of a savings there, but I guess there's two very different examples of where engagement with business is benefiting that community planning. Did you want to add anything further, David?
Just something very, very brief. Mr. McKee mentioned Scottish Enterprise. What I picked up from some of the evidence given by previous witnesses was there was maybe a bit of a difference in response between, on the one hand, Scottish Enterprise and Visit Scotland, whose maybe role is more national or closer to national, compared with South of Scotland Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, which consider themselves actually to have a strong role in community planning. Now, the way the community planning arrangements work, and this is set out in the guidance, allows for different partners to have differentiated approaches, depending on actually how much difference they can make. But maybe just one other point to make is that, you know, ideally what we'd be looking for is a bit of a golden thread running between economic ambitions at national, regional and local level. And there was a report that the Community Planning Improvement Board produced in 2021, which included an annex basically summarising key findings of community planning since the Act. One of the things that it recognised or it found was that CPPs had been effective in using city, region and growth deals as a way of supporting CPP's own strategic objectives, including or particularly around addressing economic disadvantage locally.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely fair to say that High and Sozzies have got a different remit, and I think that's well recognised. But I was just surprised that there was no role for Gateway in there, who I would have thought would have been the agency that would have been engaged with local business communities much more than SE, but that's the point. Okay.
And that is something we can reflect on.
And frankly, SE have got their, in terms of resource constraints, they need to prioritise, and this stuff probably isn't really adding any value, to be honest. But okay.
Well, I guess the example from the Western Isles shows that, there's not a blockage to that connection with Business Gateway or other organisations.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
So what's appropriate to the local locality and the communities.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thanks, Evan. I think we'll try to go back to Councillor Heddle and see if we can get him to respond to both of your questions, because I think it would be good to hear from COSLA on that. Can you remember the two questions?
I think so. Refresh my memory if I fail. Apologies for this connection issue. This connection has been rock solid for 3 years. It's just a pain. It's not working today. I think the initial question was around communities feeling disengaged increasingly, going from 24% to, I think it was, 16%. And I think a very good point was made by David Milne around the, well, you feel engaged if your action leads to another action. And I think there is a difficulty that there's an inability to respond to requests through the CPP or through council channels due to lack of funding. If somebody complains about a hole in the road and you can't fix it, they're not going to feel particularly empowered. And I think there's also the kind of larger context of disillusionment in democracy post-Brexit, which I think is maybe cascading down through all levels. But I mean, there's no excuse to not try and do things better. And I think the point being made around involvement of third sector interfaces in the voluntary sector is important. From my perspective, I think it's essential that they're involved, and it's essential that they're empowered to aid us in our consultation and communication with the communities. And I see them as a key part of the community planning partnership. Certainly in Orkney, they lead one of our four key priorities and do it very well. In terms of the role of businesses, absolutely, the COVID pandemic has shown that we need to reach out to businesses more, find out what is ailing them. The HIE sit on our community planning partnership in Orkney, and again lead one of our priorities, the economic development priority. And the formerly, of course, there was the local enterprise companies and far more devolution locally. The chief of Orkney Enterprise had a chequebook that he could write £100,000 cheques in to respond to issues, which is a flexibility that doesn't pertain these days. So we need to reach out to business organisations, either through the economic development agencies as proxies, through chambers of commerce if they exist, or through informal business groupings if they don't. On the role of SE in this, I would say SE should have a role. And their national role at present is perhaps through their own choice due to their own funding issues, and that they should be engaging more with businesses and pipelining businesses towards Business Gateway. But I think that's a separate conversation.
Thanks very much for that. And now I'm going to pick up the theme of local outcome improvement plans and locality plans, the kind of practical tools. The 2015 Act replaced the single outcome agreements with the local outcome improvement plans. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on what impact this has had. And maybe I'll start with Councillor Heddle.
Well, for the point of view of the change, I mean, the single outcome agreements obviously ordered more flexibility due to the fact that it was an era of less ring fencing, and we could have more flexibility to direct our resources, certainly to local authorities, and but I would suggest probably collectively as well. The local outcome improvement plans have, in terms of the meeting the reporting requirements of the Scottish Government, has been a kind of fairly painless and logical evolution. Though I would say the single outcome agreement was always felt to be a more significant document. I mean, it was a kind of partnership document with the Scottish Government, but it was the quid pro quo for the flexibility of funding. But I don't want to devalue the LOIPs. I think the fact that they are revisited on an annual basis maintains focus and allows kind of priorities to evolve. And yeah, I think as time goes, the priorities become more relevant. I suppose the issue that can happen is that in rightly developing these priorities, which are very, very local, we're creating more indicators to report on that don't necessarily align with the indicators in the local government benchmarking framework, which is the, I think, probably our gold standard for the things that we should be reporting on. And I think as we consider the local governance review and the New Deal, the possibility of de-ring fencing of funds and more of a focus on outcomes. We need to look at the LOIPs, we need to look at the local government benchmarking framework and indicators and come to something that's perhaps more streamlined, more focused on outcomes and more focused on early intervention and prevention, as was the aspiration in the first place for community planning partnerships. But to reflect also that, you know, this is necessarily a long game that you're playing if you're doing early intervention and prevention, and it has to be something that is given a chance to endure and succeed. I mean, I reflect on my early days as a council leader back in 2012, 2013, and there was a great store set by the early years collaboratives. That's about 10 years ago, and there's going to be £1 billion directed towards that. Now, I have no idea if this was allowed to come to fruition or what the impact of that was, but it certainly seemed something that could have been transformational. So, you know, whether this was allowed to succeed or whether I've just taken my eye off the ball and haven't seen it succeeding, I'm not sure. But I think the kind of the message is that it's a long game, and that we need to stick with it and recognise perhaps that it's going to be difficult to report in the early years of that initiative.
Thanks very much for that. And Minister?
Yeah, I think thanks for the comments here, which largely are similar to the notes that I have in front of me. I think LOIPs are really important. It's so important that they're ambitious yet realistic, and that focus on improving outcomes and reducing inequalities. I think in terms of the concept of the New Deal going forward, we kind of really need to understand outcomes better and understand what it is we're trying to achieve. Andrew, do you want to talk a little bit about what that might mean going forward, kind of in the context of the New Deal?
Yeah. So I think within the context of the New Deal, I think it's the government's position that we're still in that sort of listening and learning mode as part of our informal review, sort of what works within the context of community planning, how are LOIPs operating in practice, what needs to change, excuse me, if anything, and sort of as part of that listening and learning mode, working closely with COSLA, working closely with the Community Planning Improvement Board, and reflecting on their feedback from their partners, and bringing that back to the Scottish Government to sort of see what updates we might want to provide in any guidance if there is an ask or a need for any updates there.
Thanks very much for that. I think the point that Councillor Heddle made also, and I think the Minister touched on it a bit, is this bit about getting streamlined around the indicators and the, you know, looking at the local government benchmark frameworks as being the gold standard. And I think it's always that thing of we need to be looking at how do we... it's my next question, so I'll just ask my next question, which is how do you think partners should tackle the challenge of LOIPs aligning with other strategic plans, and how do partners connect their CPP duties with other areas of responsibility like integration, joint boards, locality planning, and Councillor Heddle, also children's services planning? So maybe I'll start with Councillor Heddle and then come to the Minister.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair. If you don't mind, I would probably like to involve my COSLA colleagues, because I know that they have a greater expertise than I do in responding to this, and you know they've been admirably quiet so far.
Absolutely welcome. I don't know who to call on, though, but Simon.
Hi there. Yes. Sorry, can you just repeat the question for me? That would be fantastic.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. So I'd be interested to hear how partners, how you think partners should tackle the challenge of LOIPs aligning with other strategic plans, and how do you think partners can connect their CPP duties with other areas of responsibility like IJBs, locality planning and children's services planning?
Yeah, I think that's a significant challenge, and I think I suppose I would reflect on the opportunity with the New Deal in terms of between ourselves and Scottish Government in terms of trying to align that. Obviously, there's a broad range of strategies that come from across government to try and impact on the benefits of local communities and the life experiences of those that we deliver essential services to. I think that's where we would reflect in something such as the local governance review and the opportunity that provides to look at the whole system and ask ourselves the question of the alignment of the priorities that we're looking to make. Obviously, local outcome improvement plans are very much that. They are what local communities A, prioritise, B, feel that they need, and C, want to see happen across their area, and that will have the greatest impact on their life opportunities and their life chances. Now, whilst clearly there will remain high-level strategic outcomes that we want to see for the whole of Scotland, I think being able to embrace an asymmetric approach and encourage local partners from national bodies to see the impact of taking different approaches and working together through the CPP is of kind of critical need for us. And that's why I reflect the local governance review. If we continue in the manner that we are with that piece of work, for example, looking at single island authorities, and indeed Councillor Heddle's own area will be one of the lead areas in terms of how we might do that, it provides the opportunity for local and national partners to come together and work and operate in different ways that truly does place place-based approaches and communities at the heart of what they're doing.
Thanks very much for that, Simon. And Minister?
Yes, yeah, so it's really important that we work to prevent a clutter on the landscape where we have different bodies and the CPPs are actually ideally placed to help with that. So I think one of the examples that you had would be with Community Planning Aberdeen, where the Aberdeen Health and Social Care Partnership used common data. So it kind of shows that it is possible to have, you know, one set of data, for instance, which is used by multiple partners. The challenge with, as we're counting more things and expecting more reporting, that becomes burdensome, and that's one of the things that we really need to be mindful of going forward, particularly in terms of what we're trying to do around the New Deal for local government. But David, did you want to maybe talk a little bit more about the how those groups all interface?
Sure. Thanks, Minister. And yes, I suppose there are a couple of levels to this. One is about how the partnerships connect and interconnect. And I guess when we were framing the statutory guidance for community planning back in 2016, one of the things that we wanted to try and ensure was that there was nothing in the statutory guidance which placed artificial controls or barriers in terms of how different partnerships arrangements worked. So there's flexibility, at least from a community planning guidance perspective, to link in with other partnership arrangements however you want. So you sometimes find actually there's the children's services partnership are actually part of the community planning partnership structure in some instances. And I think it's fair to say that at least in several or in some cases that's been reciprocated in guidance for other partnership arrangements or other planning arrangements. So, for instance, with local place plans, there's an expectation on community bodies there to have regard to the relevant locality plan that's all already been established. So there's something there about the architecture. The other thing I think maybe just to highlight is actually the underpinning kind of drive and motivation here. And across government, as a committee, you're hopefully seeing across a wide range of policy areas a clear and common focus on public sector organisations working together and with communities on place-based, person-centred approaches, whole systems in many cases that actually work in the round to tackle disadvantage, support economic development in sustainable ways and more. And that's also increasingly being reflected in Scottish Government's own relationships with its public bodies. So coming out of the last Scottish budget, where one of the priorities there is about sustainable public services, that has led government to enter into discussions or conversations with public bodies across Scotland about how they ensure that they remain sustainable in future, with a strong emphasis on working in partnership and a strong emphasis on prevention as being important both to prevent the human cost and disadvantage, but also actually to help keep public services fiscally sustainable long term by moderating demand on expensive crisis intervention services. So I think what this is hopefully driving is a greater sense of shared collective ambition, which provides, if you like, a common basis for local partnership working.
Thanks very much for that. Now I'm going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the committee have heard during the inquiry that CPPs struggle to demonstrate how activities are leading to improved outcomes, as this is required by the 2015 Act. What more can the Scottish Government and other public bodies do to help CPPs demonstrate impact?
Yeah, so I mean, I guess it kind of follows back from the last question where we talked about making sure that we weren't overly burdening all of our public bodies in terms of producing data. But again, I wonder if that is the answer to that, is to making sure that we are collecting the correct data, both whether it's quantitatively or qualitatively, and then making sure that we can share that to understand progress towards improving local outcomes. I think that's maybe the best answer there.
Thank you. The committee understands that the Scottish Government is conducting a review of the Community Empowerment Act, but Part 2 of the Act has not been reviewed. What is the reason for this, and does the Government have any plans to review community planning in the future? And community groups have voiced during the inquiry that reform is needed.
Yeah, so I think the Part 2 of the Act has been reviewed by an informal process, which felt like the appropriate level of... it's all about making sure we're using resources collectively, but David...
Thank you. We, the Minister at the time took the decision that last year that Part 2 should be included within the scope of the review of parts of the Community Empowerment Act. We've used terminology like informal just to provide assurance from the very start that there's no question of government questioning its continued commitment to community planning. So everything was the focus on how do we build on the strengths of community planning and take it further. And so far, we've had the advantage of having the Community Planning Improvement Board, which has in any case undertaken work to consider how community planning can more effectively take forward some of the key challenges, particularly around the COVID recovery priorities of improving well-being for children and young people and household income for families at risk, as well as addressing climate change challenges. So there's a report from that and that, and the committee's findings will inform government's further work on review. Convener, at the start, you made the point about Andrew and I having the same job titles. The reason for that is I've had responsibility for community planning for a while. Andrew is now taking over, so that will be his joy as we move on.
Total joy.
If we should see if Councillor Heddle wants to come in on question 11 around the kind of demonstrating that activities are leading to the improved outcomes. Councillor Heddle, I don't know if you picked up Marie's first question.
I'm afraid no, I was in the void at that point.
Okay, in the void. Okay, do you want to ask it again?
Sure. Please. The committee have heard during the inquiry that CPPs may struggle to demonstrate how activities are leading to improved outcomes. As this is a requirement of the 2015 Act, what more can the Scottish Government and other public bodies do to help CPPs demonstrate impact? We'd be grateful for your impact.
Yeah, well, I'll try. Yeah, I think we maybe kind of addressed this in the previous answers around the, what are the appropriate indicators and what are the ones that are reflective of outcomes, and what are the ones that are reflective of kind of shared priorities of the partners. I think there's work to be done there. I recognise that there's perhaps a disconnect between activity and being able to demonstrate the impact. And I think it's only appropriate to say that I think we can do better here. And but in return to my theme that we, if we can declutter our indicators, if we can bring things to a kind of coherent focus related to the local government benchmarking framework. But obviously, it's not just local government that's reporting here. It's the partnership and other bodies. So recognise that perhaps need to go beyond that, but remain coherent with the LGBF. I think would be the kind of main point that I would make there. And the other point I was trying to make that in moving towards prevention. Moving towards early intervention to recognise that it's a long game to play here. But in terms of the number of indicators and the number of objectives, obviously the number of partners that's in the partnership have different priorities and sort of pull in different directions. And this is a personal opinion here. Sometimes I wonder if we should just pick on some very few objectives, something like child poverty, and just say, OK, we're going to concentrate on child poverty here. Because if we fix child poverty, we're obviously fixed employment, housing, general poverty, and we've obviously contributed demonstrably to early intervention and prevention at the same time. I think streamlining is the probably the answer, perhaps not as drastic as I've just suggested, but I think that's an example of the thinking that we could be doing as we contemplate these things.
Thanks very much for that. And I think that a streamlining approach is true. It's like it is that thing. Where's the intervention point that will give us the most impact for the activities that we carry out? And I think that leads nicely on to Willie Coffey's contribution. He's leading on the theme of leadership, accountability and audit.
Thanks again, convener, and good morning to you once more. I wanted to touch on issues about leadership, Minister and Councillor Hadle, a little bit on accountability and whether there's a role for audit in the CPP process. The committee has heard some great examples of how CPPs are working particularly well in a number of areas of Scotland, but it's not uniform, it's not across the board. And perhaps some CPPs need some assistance and help to improve. And one of the ingredients we think may contribute to that is effective local leadership. And it's just to get your views on whether you agree with that. One of the comments made by someone at the committee was really, really useful, I think. It said that effective leaders should leave at the door their silos, their logos and their egos. And that kind of struck a chord, I think, with the members in the committee. So, broadly speaking, Minister, do you agree with that? And is there a job of work to be done in trying to share this good practice and local leadership to get the CPPs more effective?
Yeah, leave the silos, logos and egos at the door. I think that's going to be a good slogan for most partnership working. But there is good examples of shared leadership, and I think it's becoming more widespread as the systems embed, and so we are seeing some really good examples across the country, and some of which you have heard, and I think that then improves the relationships, which then makes a difference when something particularly unusual happens, for instance. So through COVID, I think the kind of shared leadership model allowed for a response at a local level, which probably wouldn't have been possible if those connections hadn't already been made, and that kind of wider respect and shared leadership. So very often there wasn't, a need for formal CPP meetings to take a COVID response, but the connections had already been made. So I think the premise of your question about leaving the silos, logos and egos, I think you're absolutely right. And we need to look at the best examples that there are in terms of taking that forward. The CPIB's 2021 Progress and Potential Report highlighted that there was widespread support and commitment to community planning and that it continued to be seen as an important vehicle for coordinating multi-agency work. So on that basis, I think people need to then take the next step and recognise that needs to be taken forward with shared local leadership. CPBIB obviously have been doing a fair bit of work to help us guide how the system might be improved going forward. Any further, David?
Super. Thank you, Minister. Maybe just one point on Mr. Coffey raised the question of scrutiny as well in there. So just one part of that. Obviously, the Accounts Commission is independent of Scottish Government, so it reaches its own conclusions. However, it does assess how well local authorities work in partnership with others, including through community planning, in their annual performance audits and occasional best value audits that they undertake of local authorities. And a minister's request, some of the inspectorates, so including Healthcare Improvement Scotland, Care Inspectorate, HMI, CS and Education Scotland, are undertaking a series of joint inspections into how services work in the round to provide care and support both for adults and for children, young people. The reason I mention that is that that's already getting into the territory of how public services work around what matters to people. The chair of the Accounts Commission also chairs a group called the Strategic Scrutiny Group, which brings senior leaders from scrutiny bodies together. Partly it's about coordinating local government audit and inspections so that there's not three buses turning up at the same time at a local authority's door. But also it's about actually reflecting on how audit and inspection can better reflect some of the reform aspirations which Councillor Hedl was referring to earlier, based on Christie around prevention and engaging with communities and shared leadership. So government officials are part of that group as well, so that those discussions do take place while respecting the independence of the Accounts Commission. And again, and I look to Andrew in saying this, I think this is something that our own further review work can consider.
Thanks for that, David. Councillor Herald, could you just maybe offer a few comments on the leadership issue? You must see across COSLA really good, effective community planning partnerships working and perhaps some that need to improve. And do you think the successful ingredient there is local leadership, providing that kind of dynamic engagement with local people on the ground? And is that something we can share across most of the authorities in Scotland, in your view?
Yeah, I would agree with your point that local leadership is hugely important, and you know, emphasise the local aspect of that. I might bring in my colleagues to do the kind of the. Apologies. I think we lost Councillor Heddle again, and.
We see you.
Okay, that's great, thanks. Yeah, so apologies, yes, having lost the Councillor Heddle again, hopefully you'll be able to come back in. I think, obviously, as Councillor Heddle was saying, kind of the importance of kind of local leadership absolutely kind of essential in this kind of space. And in terms of, you know, in the sharing, obviously the CPIB, the Community Planning Improvement Board itself, is doing an awful lot of work to make sure that that sharing of good practice is happening across Scotland. And through COSLA, through things such as elected members' bulletins, etc., and the rest, we are continuously improving and highlighting to colleagues across the country through not only that elected members' briefing opportunity, but also through all of our professional networks, the areas of good practice that are happening. And yet again, I suppose there's a reflection into where through things such as the local government benchmarking framework and the work that goes on with our colleagues in the Improvement Service, yet again being able to highlight the work that the individual councils are taking. And we've heard a lot about it today, for example, the work in North Ayrshire around community wealth building, etc. These are matters that are brought to not only the floor of COSLA leaders, but also through the COSLA boards that we've got, and yet again, a broad range of effective learning spaces that we've got and professional networks that we have.
Thanks for that. We'll just while we wait and hope that Councillor Heddle comes back in, I could maybe move on and just ask a query to the Minister about broader accountability and the role for audit. Again, Joe, we know that CPPs don't have they're not formal accountable bodies, but they're very much part of that reporting process that sits in there with the planning partnerships and their agencies that they work with. But Where should the accountability line go with CPPs, do you think? Should there be one? Should there be a formal accountability channel? And I remember Audit Scotland did a report on CPPs and their effectiveness about 10 years ago on the 10th anniversary of the CPPs, and one of their comments at that time was that they weren't able to show they had a significant impact in delivering local outcomes. Now, I think that's changed significantly in the last 10 years, and you've given a number of examples yourself, but where do you see the kind of accountability and audit role sitting? Should it be Audit Scotland or the Accounts Commission or some other mechanism or none at all?
Yeah. Well, obviously, Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission have a particular role in looking at the landscape, and you know, Audit Scotland particularly have been able to highlight in a way that maybe others couldn't with confidence that there has been a shift in terms of the focus for council chief executives' leadership, for instance, no longer just about leading their own organisation, but now they universally see the kind of wider partnership and collaborative leadership as part of their role. We need to be careful that we're not creating bureaucracy that then becomes a block to delivering the outcomes and the benefit for our communities. So I think that's really important, and I think we do that by collaboration. So if we can have a shared understanding across all the partners about what the outcomes we're trying to achieve. Councillor Heddle kind of suggested that should be slimmed down, and while, as I think he said, having one outcome might be going further than we'd want to go. I think that's probably a sensible thing for us to do, and that's some of the discussions that we are currently having with COSLIST about, you know, what are the most important outcomes that we're trying to achieve. And if we have a shared understanding of that across all of the partners, then it becomes much easier for us to see, for the public to see. The public aren't really concerned about whether this is an outcome that's been, or a measure that's been produced by Audit Scotland, or it's or the Accounts Commission, they want to see the difference on the ground. They want to see services in their communities and in their places.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that, Joe. Now, Councillor Headler, I see that you're back. I wonder if you just heard that query there. It's about where is the accountability line? Where is it? Where should it be? Should it be formally audited by bodies like Audit Scotland, the Accounts Commission, or should we not go there? But how do we demonstrate that outcomes are being achieved?
I can come to that point via the point I was going to make before I was cut off, if that's okay. Yep. Which is around your point about the importance of local leadership, which I wholly agree. And I can strongly believe that local leaders have to be invested in the partnership. They have to be like directors when they're sitting on the partnership. Their obligation is to the aspirations of the partnership. But I mean, to be able to do that, they need to be empowered fiscally and functionally to do so. No, I think as local authorities, we are totally invested in the community planning partnerships. And we need to make sure that our partners are similarly invested. And it's not just that the Mercy kind of personalities perspectives. When I was the leader of the Community Planning Partnership, we had a rotten inspection from the Rotten Best Value Review. It was turned into a good Best Value Review. And the Community Planning Partnership was humming at that point because it was a reality check to everybody. And the partners were chastened and invested. And you know, it's how do you manage to keep that going? And I think it's incumbent on kind of ministers and agencies to direct and empower their participants in the community planning partnerships, or proxies in the community planning partnerships, their local people, because the kind of local aspect and the police aspect has to be retained, because this is what we're responding to. We're responding to our communities. So I think a kind of more directive approach from the agencies and ministers to say community planning partnership is a serious thing and you've got to take it seriously would help to maintain a kind of continuity of that. But returning to your question whether we should be auditing this, well, I would say we're already auditing it. The kind of the best value reviews that we've had in the past, do take a very forensic look at the operation of the partnership, and sometimes an unsparing look. So I don't know whether we need to augment that in any way.
Okay. Many thanks, everybody, for your contributions and comments. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks, Will. Thanks, Willie. So that actually concludes our questions, and I think it's been a really useful discussion. And I think it's been powerful to have both the Scottish Government and COSLA in the same space responding to our questions. And it was heartening to hear local governance review mentioned quite a number of times, and also the New Deal mentioned a good number of times, and to hear that you're kind of working on those areas, something that we're taking a strong interest in. But I think it's been really useful to hear your perspectives on the community planning partnership, and I think we'll take that away, and it's going to be a useful element to add to our report. And also really grateful to hear that you've already been paying attention to the work we've been doing in this area, and glad that we could contribute constructively in that way. So many thanks for joining us this morning. At the start, as we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next item in private, that was the last public item. I now close the public part of the meeting.